Thank you, sir. I'll be discussing on rhinosinusitis. Next slide. According to the recent studies of European Position paper, we define the rhinosinusitis according to the diagnosis which is made. It is made according to the clinical symptoms and which is combined with objective evidence of mucosal inflammation. I'll show a chart in the next slide. We categorize this into a primary symptom and additional symptom. In the primary symptom, at least one should be present or both can be present to confirm the diagnosis. The symptoms are nasal blockage, obstruction, congestion or nasal discharge. Nasal discharge can come anteriorly or post-nasally. Additional symptoms should be present along with one of the primary symptoms. If only one primary symptom is present, additional symptoms should be there to confirm the diagnosis. Additional symptoms include facial pain, pressure, olfaction, olfactory disturbance and hyposmia or anosmia. According to duration, it can be categorized into acute or chronic. If it is less than 3 months, we categorize into acute sinusitis. If it is more than 3 months, we categorize into chronic sinusitis. On the basis of endoscopy, nasal polyp, mucopurulent discharge, presence of edema in or mucosal obstruction in the middle meatus. CT findings confirms our diagnosis if there is any mucosal thickening, etc. We'll be talking about acute and chronic sinusitis only. Acute sinusitis, as I told you, it is less than 3 months. The bacteria and virus both causes acute sinusitis. Only 0.5 to 2% of the bacteria causes acute sinusitis. These are the common organisms which causes the sinusitis, among which influenza, Haemophilus influenza is the most common bacteria, which accounts for about 40%, and rhinovirus, which accounts for about 50% of the infection. The most common predisposing factor for acute sinusitis are the anatomical variation, allergy and smoking. What are the pathogenesis? How does acute sinusitis occur? The pathogens of virus goes into the cell, into the respiratory epithelium, which causes the inflammatory change. These inflammatory change will cause epithelial damage, which in turn causes humoral and cellular defense to be activated. In bacteria, bacteria usually occurs after a viral infection. So this causes decrease in amount of the ciliated epithelial cells. The goblet cell increases, which causes the sinus obstruction. This sinus obstruction causes mucosa to accumulate inside the sinus, which provides the medium for bacteria to grow. For confirming to be a bacterial sinusitis, at least 3 of these symptoms should be present. There should be a discolored nasal discharge, which usually present predominantly on unilateral side. There should be a local pain, unilateral most probably. It can be present with fever or elevated CRP or ESR. So, the chronic rhinosinusitis is now defined, differentiated into chronic sinusitis with polyposis and chronic sinusitis without polyposis. Next slide. In the chronic sinusitis with nasal polyposis, there will be an intense edema in the stoma. There will be albumin deposition and pseudocyst formation. Subepithelial inflammatory cells will be present. This is called the super antigen theory. There will be a fungal, if there is a fungal super antigen or a bacterial super antigen which causes biofilm or eosinophilic formation. This in turn causes inflammatory cells around the mucosa of the sinuses. This is cause of the chronic sinusitis with nasal polyposis. In the sinusitis without the nasal polyposis, there will be fibrosis, basement membrane thickening, there will be more goblet cell, subepithelial edema will be there. Mononuclear cell infiltrate will be present. Diagnosis. the diagnosis, the gold standard diagnosis for sinusitis is endoscopy and CT sinus. Vast majority of investigations are available, but gold standard investigation is only CT and diagnostic nasal endoscopy. Next. The first slide first shows nasal polyposis in the nasal cavity. This is a fungus which is present in the nasal cavity. Allergic mucin. This is both a chronic sinusitis which shows discolored mucus secretions and edematous mucosa. These are the CT scans showing the accumulation of tissues here. And this is the inferior turf layer. This is mostly concentrating on the ethmoid and maxillary sinus. In this scan, you can see double densities, which is a classical of a fungal sinusitis. So we move on to the treatment. The gold standard treatment for medical management and surgical management are there. There is something called as the maximal medical therapy. Maximal medical therapy is something which you give for 4 to 6 weeks. If the medical therapy fails, you move on to surgery. So what are the main aims? Our main aim is to reduce the inflammatory load, to reduce the bacterial load, and we have to improve the ciliary function. Antibiotics. Antibiotics, the more only 2% of the sinusitis is caused by bacteria. So the correct antibiotic to be specified is after taking a culture from the middle meatus. So the most common antibiotic which could be prescribed are cephalosporin, amoxiclav stands out to be the first line of antibiotic, and macrolides. The role of topical steroids. Topical steroids decreases the polyp size, increases the nasal symptoms, and decreases the nasal symptoms. The most common corticosteroids which are used are fluticasone and mometasone. Usually, the cortical steroids are prescribed for a longer time. People tend to ask how long can I prescribe a corticosteroid? So, what are the common complication? Less than 1% only causes epistaxis and mucosal atrophy. It is very rare in children also. If the patient presents with epistaxis, you can stop the corticosteroid for some time and you can start again. Load, how do you give the steroidal therapy? So you lie down in the supine position, head down, give the steroid. So there is a maximum, it goes towards the sphenoid sinus. This is called as the namas position, where you go into a namas position and give the topical steroid or topical agent, most penetration towards the frontal. Decongestant have little, according to recent studies and papers, decongestant has a little role in controlling sinusitis. Little or more. Systemic steroids can be given for a shorter time. It can be used in combination. It can be given only for a shorter time. But it has been proved in papers that it reduces the polyp size and improves the nasal symptoms. Leukotrienes. According to the symptom of the patient, you can give leukotriene antagonist. It can reduce the facial pain, it can reduce sneezing, but it doesn't have any effect on the polyp size. This is a nasal irrigation. Hypertonic saline wash and isotonic saline wash. There is a bottle this patient has been using. So there is a mark in that, which is around 100 and 200. If you fill lukewarm water in that, around 100, it is hypertonic. If it goes around 200, it is isotonic. So, how to use this? You ask the patient to lean forward, put the device in one nostril, and ask the patient to say KKK continuously, so that it washes all the mucin, infected crust and inflammatory agents and comes out to the other nostrils. You can do that on either nostrils, once or twice a day. Next. Immunoregulation. This is immunoregulation. Monoclonal antibody has been used to reduce the polyp size. The reason monoclonal antibodies are omalizumab and mepolizumab, which has been proved to improve the nasal symptoms and reduce the polyp size. I will be showing a short video on how sinus surgery is being done. If the medical management fails, we have to go for a surgical management, which is called as a FIS. You can see a polyp inside the nasal cavity, the right side. This is the inferior turbinate. So this is called as a debrider. So we use it to debride the inflammatory cell. The surgery is mainly done to reduce the inflammatory load for better penetration of the drug. Now the debrider is being used in the region of the middle meatus. This is a polyp which is debrided. This is not my video. So what we do is, we luminize the airway. We remove all the inflammatory load. We open up all the sinuses. Right from the maxillary, the ethmoid, to the sphenoid. So this will improve the drug delivery system. So whatever topical agents you are using, it can penetrate and go faster. Thank you. I do not discuss about allergic sinusitis. If the patient, it depends upon the patient's symptom. If the patient is having allergic symptoms, you can give antihistamines. It is a group of combination of treatments. So if the inflammatory load is this much, the steam inhalation is not going to work.
Now I request you, Dr. Srinivasan Varma, please come forward. He is the right person to give the certificate to Dr. G. Arvind Kumar.